So we all use the internet every day for lots of useful things. We use it to surf the web, we use it to check email, we listen to music, we make phone calls. But how many of us actually think about what happens to our traffic once it leaves the screen in front of us and goes out into the wider internet to bring back all this useful information that we're then using? So actually what's going on here is we have a whole complex underlying internet, which is basically like a plumbing system that's allowing this information to come back and forth to us. And so what we do in my research lab is we study some of these core internet protocols, and one of these really important core internet protocols is called BGP. So BGP, or the Border Gateway Protocol, is the glue that holds the internet together. It allows communications between networks worldwide, so for example, allowing AT&T to communicate with China Telecom, Level 3, Verizon Wireless, and even our own network here at Boston University. So BGP is used in order to allow all of these huge networks to reach all of the individual machines inside these networks. So for example, inside Verizon Wireless, there's a group of machines that have machine addresses called IP addresses. These IP addresses belong to the same group, which we call an IP prefix. So here you can see the IP prefix from Verizon Wireless. So BGP is used to inform all of these networks worldwide how they can reach individual IP prefixes like the one right here in Verizon Wireless. And so how is this done? Verizon Wireless will send a BGP message to Level 3 saying that it is the owner of the IP addresses inside this prefix. Level 3 will learn this, and now it knows how to reach the machines inside Verizon Wireless, and it will tell the rest of the network about this by sending its own BGP message saying that this IP prefix can be reached through the path from Level 3 to Verizon Wireless. So the thing about this protocol is none of the messages that are sent through this protocol are actually authenticated. And what that means is networks can actually start to make claims and send false information that can mess up all of this routing. So let me show you a very, very oversimplified example of something that happened on April 8th, 2010. So on that date, China Telecom sent a BGP message like this that actually contained the IP prefix that belonged to Verizon Wireless. This is very confusing because the IP prefix and the machines that actually have these addresses are located inside Verizon Wireless, but China Telecom was claiming that they were located inside their own network. So in order to do this, they send the BGP message over to AT&T, and now AT&T has a choice. It has this message here that it learned from China Telecom and this message over here that it learned from Level 3, and so what should it do? Well, in fact, if you look at these two messages, you can see that the one through China Telecom is shorter. It's of length 1, as compared to the one through Level 3, which is actually of length 2. And so what AT&T ended up doing was selecting the route through China Telecom and sending all traffic intended for machines inside Verizon Wireless to China Telecom instead. So what we do in my lab is we try to understand how we can secure this system. So this is a problem that engineers and researchers have been working on for the last 20 years, and we haven't made all that much progress towards the deployment of real solutions in the field. So what do we actually need to do in order to prevent incidents like the China Telecom prefix hijack? What we need is a system that will securely tell us which IP prefixes belong to which networks. And so why don't we just design and deploy such a system throughout the entire internet? Well, let me give you an idea why this problem is so hard. So if we look at our network here, we can see we have China Telecom, which is based in China. We have Verizon Wireless, based in the US. And here we have two networks, AT&T and Level 3, which are multinational. Each one of these networks can make its own local decisions on which security solution it wants to deploy. And so what we do in my lab is try to understand what happens when we deploy security solutions at some networks, but not others. What kind of global security properties do we get in the system? And what kind of security solutions we should be designing for this environment where we have lots of autonomous actors making their own decisions, but each one of these local decisions has global implications on the security of the whole network.